So in this video we are going to discuss about hydraulic machines. So basically here we will see about pumps and turbines. So the basic concept of any hydraulic machine, or we can say principle of a hydraulic machine, is to convert hydraulic energy into mechanical energy. So hydraulic machines are used to convert either hydraulic energy or mechanical energy, or mechanical energy into hydraulic energy, vice versa. So in turbines we are converting hydraulic energy into mechanical energy, and that mechanical energy is used to run the turbines, and indirectly we are getting electricity from that. And in the converse way, in pumps we are using hydraulic energy to lift water. So hydraulic energy we are converting to mechanical energy. So these are two major examples. So basically three types of turbines here we will discuss, that is Kaplan, Pelton and Francis. So if we will talk about pumps, that is only here we will focus on centrifugal and reciprocating pumps. So turbines are defined as the hydraulic machines which convert hydraulic energy into mechanical energy. So this mechanical energy is used in running an electric generator which is directly coupled to the shaft of the turbine. So there is a shaft, and that shaft is carrying a particular type of magnet, and the whole assembly will rotate inside a copper winded coil. So with we are knowing with electromagnetic induction, electricity will be produced if any magnetic field is generated inside a copper winded coil. So electricity will be produced. So those things we will discuss also in hydroelectric power plant in this module. So this hydraulic energy is used to convert to produce hydroelectric power. Now it is one of the very cheapest energy source. So first we will see here about hydroelectric power plant. So we are knowing that we are constructing dams or barrage or any type of obstruction in the normal routine flow of water, that is rivers or any type of channels, to store water. So at the upstream side there will be impounding or storage of water, which we are calling it as reservoir. Now in the downstream side we are allowing water to pass through a special gated arrangement, that is sluice gates. So when we are allowing water to go from higher to lower level, from upstream to downstream, we are allowing water to pass through turbines. So for that we are using penstocks. So these are large diameter RCC pipe, reinforced cement concrete pipes, which carry water under pressure from the storage reservoir to the turbines. And turbine having different types of vanes. So vanes are the blades. These we are also calling it as buckets, vanes, buckets or plates. So in the downstream side water level we will call it as tail race, and in the upstream side water level we are calling it as head race. So tail race, which is channel which carries water away from the turbine after the water has worked on the turbine. The surface of water in the tail race channel is also known as tail race. That is the downstream side level, water level. So this is the layout of hydroelectric power plant. In this schematic diagram we can see that in the upstream side we have constructed a dam, and then with this penstock we are allowing water to go from upstream to downstream side. So this is large diameter RCC pipes which are known as penstock, and at the outlet we are attaching a nozzle. Nozzle is a narrower cross section at the outlet. So to satisfy continuity equation, that is A1V1 is equal to A2V2, since here cross sectional area is reduced drastically, so velocity of flow will be high and this will create jets. And when this jets coming with high velocity strike the vanes of the turbine, the whole assembly will rotate. Indirectly, the shaft will rotate. So here some terms we have to understand. First is headrest, that is the water level in the upstream side, and tailrest, water level at the downstream side. And if we'll take a reference or a datum level, so headrest to that particular datum level, we will call it as gross head. Now here in the right hand side we can see there is a net head. So net head plus HF. HF is the head loss. Head losses may be major or minor. Generally frictional losses are more. So difference of gross head and net head will give us HF, head loss. So this is the layout of hydroelectric power plant. And when the electricity is being generated or produced, it is stored in transformers and then it will be routed by high rise poles and transmission cables. So here few terms is very important. Like gross head, it is the vertical difference between headrest and tailrest level. And if we'll talk about net head, that is gross head minus head losses. So here HF, the frictional losses we are considering, that is 4FL V square by 2GD, where V will be the velocity of flow in penstock, that large diameter pipe, RCC pipe, and capital L is the length of penstock, and diameter is denoted as small d. Similarly, net head we will get from this expression. Now, with respect to various types of efficiencies, we will see like hydraulic efficiency. So it is defined as the ratio of power given by the water to the runner of a turbine to the power supplied by the water at the inlet of turbine. So this is particularly a type of output power by input power. And if you want to write in terms of percentage, we have to multiply it with 100. So the power at the inlet of turbine is more, and this power goes on decreasing as the water flows over the vanes of the turbine due to the hydraulic losses, as the vanes are not smooth. Vanes are not smooth, so there will be some losses, hydraulic losses. Now the power delivered to the runner of the turbine will be less than the power available at the inlet of turbine. So efficiency we will get less than 100%, or in the range of 0 to 100%, or in decimal form we can say 0 to 1. So mathematically we can write it like this symbol is eta. Eta H is equal to power delivered to the runner RP divided by power supplied at the inlet WP. When we will multiply with 100, we will get the same 18%. Now after that we will see about mechanical efficiency. So it is the power delivered by the water to the runner of a turbine which is transmitted to the shaft of the turbine. So here, due to various mechanical losses, the power available at the shaft of the turbine is generally less than the power delivered to the runner of a turbine. So the ratio of power available at the shaft of the turbine to the power delivered to the runner is defined as mechanical efficiency. So here we are denoting it as eta F, power at the shaft of the turbine to the by power delivered by the water to the runner, SP by RP. Now very interesting thing here, hydraulic efficiency and mechanical efficiency, if we will do the product of that, then we will get overall efficiency, that is the product of hydraulic and mechanical efficiency. One more type of efficiency we are going to discuss here, that is volumetric efficiency. So the volume of water striking the runner of a turbine, volume or amount of water striking the runner of a turbine is slightly less than the volume of water supplied to the turbine. So the sum of the volume of water is discharged to the tail race without striking the runner of the turbine. So there will be not 100% impact. Some of the water will be directly going to the tail race without striking the vanes or blades of the turbine. So here the ratio of the volume of water which actually striking the runner to the volume of water supplied to the turbine is defined as volumetric efficiency. So volumetric efficiency is the ratio of volume of water actually striking the runner to the volume of water supplied to the turbine. So as already stated, overall efficiency is the product of hydraulic and mechanical efficiency. So once we will do that, we will get here shaft power by water power. Now, very interesting topic here, we will see, that is classification of turbine. So it can be classified based on various criteria or conditions, like based on energy. So it based on energy, we can group it as impulse turbine or reaction turbine. So Pelton wheel is a type of example of impulse turbine, while Kaplan and Francis are reaction turbine. So let us try to understand what is the significant difference between impulse and reaction turbine. In the impulse turbine, the flow energy to the impulse turbine is completely converted to kinetic energy before transformation in the runner. The impulse forces which are being transferred by the direction changes of the flow velocity vectors when passing the buckets creates the energy converted to mechanical energy on the turbine shaft. So this is about impulse turbine. The flow enters the runner from jet spaced around the rim of the runners, and the jet hits momentarily only a part of the circumference of the runner, only a particular portion of the runner it will hit. Now if we'll talk about reaction turbine, here both energy is responsible, so we can call it as total energy, that is the sum of kinetic and pressure energy. Firstly, it follows from a drop in pressure from inlet to outlet of the runner. This is denoted as the reaction part of the energy conversion. Secondly, the changes in the direction of the flow velocity vectors, the direction of flow velocity vectors through the runner blade channel transfer impulse forces. Impulse, momentarily forces will be applied. This is denoted as the impulse part of the energy conversion. So this is the schematic diagram of those particular turbines. So there is a casing. Inside that casing, there will be runner shaft and vanes are there, which are also known as bucket. And it is shown here downstream water level tail race, and nozzle is there, which is narrowing the flow, which creates jets. Penstocks are there, hand wheel and spear is there to regulate the flow, and water jet will be produced. So now inside, if we will try to understand what is exactly happening in a reaction turbine, so we can see water entering from the penstock, okay, and now it is trying to rotate the runner. So runner blades are there inside this spiral casing. So when water enters, it will try to rotate the whole assembly, which is mounted on a shaft. Now, if we will talk about turbine classification based on direction of flow of water through the runner, so it will be like tangential, radial, axial, and mixed. So in tangential, direction of flow is along the tangent of the runner, tangential direction of the runner. While in radial, it radially inwards or centripetal type, and radially outwards or centrifugal type. If we'll talk about axial flow turbine, water flows parallel to the axis of the turbine, and in mixed flow, water flows through the runner in radial direction but lifts in a direction parallel to the axis of rotation of the runner. These are some schematic diagrams of turbines. Right veins are there. Inlet nozzle. Now we can also classify turbines based on head, like high, medium, and low head. So high head turbine, which varies head varies from 150 to 2000 meter or even more, or even very more or small even more small quantity of water is required here, but head will be more. And in medium head, it will be 30 to 150 meter. So here moderate quantity of water is required. If we'll talk about low head turbine, so less than 30 meter, but large quantity of water required. So based on various conditions, we are using or designing a particular type of turbines. Now we can also classify turbine based on specific speed. It will be low specific speed, medium specific speed, or high specific speed. So in low specific speed, its value will be in the range of 10 to 35 for single jet, and if multiple jet or double jet is there, it will be up to 50. In medium specific speed, it will be 50 to 250, while in case of high specific speed, it will be more than 250. This is all about turbine classification based on specific speed. Now if we'll talk about Pelton wheel turbine, so this is a tangential flow turbine. So what is the meaning, we will try to understand. Like in Pelton wheel turbine, water will strike the bucket, which is also known as vane, in tangential direction of rotation. And at the inlet of the turbine, only an inlet energy is available. That is, pressure will remain constant at the inlet and outlet of the turbine. And that pressure is atmospheric pressure, 10 to 5 Pascal. Or we can call it as 760 mm of mercury, Hg, having a specific gravity 13.6. So Pelton wheel is used at very high speed and low discharge. High speed, high head, and low discharge. Now we will see what are the components of a Pelton wheel turbine. So basically, a nozzle and a flow regulating arrangement is there, like this in this figure. Penstock is there, and nozzle is attached, and jet of water is coming through it. And wheel is there, spare is there to maintain the flow or regulate the flow. The water from source is transferred through penstock to which end a nozzle is provided. Using this nozzle, the high speed water jet can be formed. To control the water jet from nozzle, a movable needle spare is arranged inside the nozzle to regulate the flow. So the spare will move backward and forward in axial direction. When it is moved forward, the flow will reduce. There will be obstruction in the passage of flow. While in the reverse case, if it will move backward, the flow will increase, and vice versa. Now, another component we will see, runners and buckets. So buckets or vanes are just like a plate which is mounted on the circumference or periphery of this runner. And this whole assembly is attached with the shaft. A Pelton wheel turbine consists of a runner, which is a circular disc on the periphery. Periphery means circumference, of which a number of buckets are mounted with equal spacing between them. There is certain equal spacing between them. And the buckets mounted are either double hemispherical or double ellipsoidal shape. A dividing wall called splitter is provided for each bucket, which separates the bucket into two equal parts. The buckets are generally made of cast iron or stainless steel or of bronze, depending upon the head of inlet of Pelton turbine. So these various materials like cast iron, stainless steel, and bronze we are using based on the head of inlet of Pelton turbine. Now casing, this is the whole arrangement of runner and buckets. Inlet and breaking jets are covered by the casing. Casing of Pelton turbine does not perform any hydraulic action, but prevents the displacing of water while working, and also the water to discharge to the tail rest. So there is no hydraulic action basically performed by this casing, but it allow that water will not go beyond a certain range. Splashing effect will not occur. And after the water has worked on the turbine, it will be smoothly released to the downstream side, tail race. That is the role played by casing. Even if you will remove this casing, we can run the turbine in this case. But in the external turbine, this is not the case. In braking jet, we will see it is used to stop the running wheel when it is not working. So we can use it as a brake system mechanism. This situation arises when the nozzle inlet is closed with the help of a spear, then the water jet is stopped on the bucket. But due to inertia, the runner will not stop revolving even after complete closure of inlet nozzle. So in that case, braking jet we are using. To stop this, a brake nozzle is provided. The brake nozzle directs the jet of water on the back of bucket to stop the wheel. The jet directed by the brake nozzle is called braking jet. So this is all about, we have seen about construction details and principle of turbines, basically Pelton wheel turbine. Now what will be the working mechanism? So the water is transferred from the high head source to a long conduit pipeline made up of RCC, reinforced cement concrete, which is known as penstock. So the nozzle arrangement at the end of penstock helps the water to accelerate and it flows out as high speed jet with high velocity and discharge at atmospheric pressure. The jet will hit the splitter of the buckets, which will distribute the jet into two halves of the bucket, and the wheel starts revolving, which is attached to a shaft. The kinetic energy of the jet is reduced when it hits the bucket, and also due to spherical shape of bucket, the directed jet will change its direction and takes U-turn and falls into tail race. So in general, the inlet angle of jet is in between 1 degree to 3 degree. After hitting the buckets, the deflected jet angle is in between 165 degree to 170 degree. Water collected in tail race should not submerge the Pelton wheel in any case. That is very important. To generate more power, two Pelton wheels can be arranged to a single shaft, or two water jets can be directed at a time to a single Pelton wheel. This is all we are doing to enhance the efficiency, to get more power also. So now if we will talk about design aspects, then we have to follow a certain set of steps. So first we are computing here velocity of jet, which we are getting with this expression V1 is equal to CV into root over 2GH. So H represent here net head, that is the difference of gross head and head losses, while CV denotes here coefficient of velocity, actual velocity by theoretical velocity. So its value will be in the range of 0.98 to 0.99, and velocity of wheel we can find by this expression phi root over 2GH, where phi represent here speed ratio. So it is a dimensionless term whose value will be in the range of 0.43 to 0.48. Now after that we are finding here angle of deflection of jet. So angle of deflection of jet after striking the bucket is taken as 165 degree if no deflection angle is given by default. Now mean diameter of the wheel, how we can find by this expression u is equal to pi dn by 60, that velocity. So d can be given by d is equal to 60 u by pi n. And jet ratio is a new term here we are introducing, which is the ratio of pitch diameter, circumferential diameter of the Pelton turbine to the diameter of the jet, diameter of the periphery of the runner to the diameter of jet. This is known as jet ratio, and generally it lies in the range of 11 to 16 for maximum hydraulic efficiency. In most of the cases it is usually considered it as 12. Now bucket dimension and number of jets, if we will talk, which is also a very salient criteria for any design of Pelton turbine. So bucket dimensions are designed in such a way that is breadth, that is the width, it should be 3 to 4 times of diameter of jet. So whatever will be the diameter of jet, let us consider it as small d, then 3d to 4d will be the width of the buckets, and length will be 2 to 3 times of the diameter of jet. And if we will talk about thickness of the buckets, it will be 0.2 to 1.2 times the diameter of jet. Now if you will talk about number of jets, so it is obtained by dividing the total rate of flow through the turbine by the rate of flow of water through a single jet. In general, number of jets are limited to 2 in case of vertical runner and 6 in case of horizontal runner. So number of buckets we can calculate from this formula. Z is equal to 15 plus D by 2D. So capital D by small d we are knowing it as small m, that is the Z ratio. So from this we will get the value of number of buckets. So this is all about design of Pelton wheel turbine. Thanks a lot for kind listening.